यस सर।
इज माई स्क्रीन विजिबल? इज माई स्क्रीन विजिबल?
यस सर।
ओके ओके
विजिबल सर।
ओके Probably we were discussing about in the last class TCP, right? So and where we stopped. So when this slide comes, we actually I think I have stopped in the last class. So we have to discuss about the TCP header and how many fields that the TCP header has and the rest, the functions of each of this field. Okay. If you look at the TCP header, the first field we have something source port number, which keeps your source port address. Similarly, we should put our destination port address. Whenever any sourcing, like source port number will be the random port number generated by the source, and the destination number is something is always be the well-known port number. Okay, for various services, for each type of service, application what you send, application service, receiver application, it will always be licensed the well-known port numbers. Okay, for a source port number, it is always be the port number in the range of dynamic range, port number range. Okay, and a heat segment should have something called sequence number. So why we need a sequence number? So we said something, we do a segmentation at a transport layer so that each segment should have a sequence number. Okay, and that field has 32 bit in size, and we have something called acknowledgement field. So acknowledgement field we use for each segment, because as a TCP connection, as a TCP is used here, every segment what you will send, there should be an acknowledgement for every packet. Okay, so that is what the acknowledgement field is. It has also having 32 bit in size. Okay, so then we have something called a header length. So header length is defines the length of the header, okay, which is of 4 bytes. It is similar to the how we understood a header length in an IPv4 packet. Okay, header length have a 4 bytes, and we should always interpret this field by multiplying with 4. Okay, so something like that. And 4 6-bits were reserved. We are not used that, and other 6 bits. Okay, we used as something called control flux. Okay, the major part we should understand in this TCP header is this 6 control flux and what is the significance of each of this bit. Okay, so we have 6 control flags, and each flags were 1-bit field. The first we said urgent field, acknowledgement field, push field, reset field, then reset flag and sync flag and fin flag. So these are all the flags. They are 1-bit. Okay, either it will be set to 1 or it will be set to 0. So when it is set to 0, is something it's default, means that flag is not been used. If they are set to 1, then something you should understand that flag control flag has been set. Okay, so we will look at each one of them. Prior to that, we just understand what are the other fields that we have. Okay, later we will mainly look at what is this field and its significance. Okay, so then later we have something called window size. So window size we should know. So if you look at the previous one, so we defined an implementation, how an implementation is implementation of this TCP could takes place, either at a sender at a receiver, and if they and they should have something having a flow control, right? So prior to them, they should know what are the size of the window, both at the sender process side and the receiver process side. Something we saw an example in the previous, isn't it? Something in order to have a flow between this sender process to receiver process, something we have a circular buffer, where in that buffer, what the sender process produce the data will be stored in there, and the, in the point of and the window size slided. You know the sliding window, that streams of bytes or that streams of packet as get wrapped into a segment, and that will be sent over and the physical network, which are responsible by the bottom three layers. Okay, each segment will be sent, and each segment will have something called sequence number. At the receiver side, it is also same thing like that. It will also have a circular buffer and keeps holds what the segment is received, and something the next process will going to be reassemble them based on the sequence number. Okay, that is what the window size here. The window size used to defines their both the process their window size. Okay. Sender process, they define the window size, and the receiver process also, they will define the window size. That's why we have in field called window size. And there is something called checksum, and checksum we know that this is for error detection. Okay, this error detection for both the header and as well as the data, and it is of 16 bits. And there is something called urgent pointer. And the ending of the byte value whenever we use a flag called urgent flag. So when we use an urgent flag, correspondingly we used to suppose to use an urgent pointer to define the starting byte value and the ending byte value of a data which is to be pushed, which is to be processed urgently prior to the data which has been sent by a sender process. Okay, that is what we call urgent pointer. Let me later explain what is that and why we use it. And there is another field called option field and a padding field. Option field, you know, so it's something is optional. So whenever we do something, a process level of like troubleshooting or something, so we use this option field for that. Okay, and we are not to worry about that much on option field. Something you just understand is an optional field. It's not been used mandatorily, but whatever the other fields you see in this header is are mandatory. Okay, so source port number, destination port number, sequence number, acknowledgement number, and the six control flags. Then we have window size, then checksum, and the is called urgent pointer. This the segment segments header, which the TCP header, it's very important. You just try by writing these fields and look at what the responsibility of each of these fields. Okay, so first we'll understand this six control flags. Okay, so first one is urgent point, urgent flag, acknowledgement flag, then push flag and reset flag, and the synchronization and the termination flag. So we said that, so whenever you initiate any TCP connection, it's went with three phases. Okay, first is connection establishment, then the data transfer, then the connection termination. For every data what you will send from anybody, from any host to any host, first it has to build a virtual connection between them, between a source and a destination. Once the virtual connection is established and they are synchronized with the sequence number, they have to synchronize. The sender should send the sequence number to a receiver, and the receiver will understand what was the sequence number used by a sender prior to it. So that the phase we set them as connection establishment. So connection establishment, in that time we use something called synchronization flag and acknowledgement flag. So synchronization flag is something, a synchronization packet or a segment which only consisting of a sequence number. So which tells, so when any host sender process sending a data, it will first use a one sequence number for a synchronization between the destination or a receiver. Okay, so that is when that time we used to set a flag, sync flag. Okay, when that synchronization flag received by a destination, he will going to send an acknowledgement for that. Okay, I come to know what is the sequence number you're going to use, so and this is an acknowledgement to you which I received and aware about that. That is what acknowledgement flag there is, and we use and we set that to one. I think you understood why these two flags were used, SYN flag and acknowledgement flag. Similarly, FIN flag, F-I-N, FIN flag is used in the connection termination phase. Whenever he wants to terminate a connection, we send a segment by setting up this flags to be one, which is which one? FIN flag, which tells that, okay, the client will be requesting to terminate the connection so that receiver or a server will send an acknowledgement. Okay. by setting it as poisonous flag. Okay, so these are the flag, whether you should understand what is kind of packet it is, whether it's a synchronization packet or it's a fin packet or acknowledgement packet or data packet. For data packet, it will not going to mention any of this. So they use the other three, what the flags that I said, urgent flag, push flag, and the reset flag. The reset flag is something self-explanatory. Whenever, if anybody, like either a client or a server, they wants to reset the connection, okay, due to some issues like due to some timeout or due to some delayed in the packet which is received by either of this entity, during that, whether they can use this flag if they want to reset the connection to the specific either a server or to a client. So that time we use something called reset flag. And other two, what push flag and urgent flag. Let me tell you about the push flag. Okay, the sender process or sender application has sent some data, okay, to a receiver process, and that has been sent over a network and has been even received by a receiver. So receiver will not immediately process it. Instead, where it will be kept in the buffer, that application buffer, right? So if your sender wants to send some data prior to that, what it been already sent, so in that case, it will use something called urgent flag. Okay, so this urgent flag, which indicates at the receiver, have they received any segment by setting up this flag, it will comes to know that without going to process what the data been waiting in the queue, I have to process the data which is been set with an urgent flag. So quite under self-explanatory this flag here is, right? So whenever he wants to send, or if you want to tell you some information to someone and which is very urgent, other than some other information, what you will do? Will you go to tell the information which is not been urgent first to a new friend, or you want to tell an information which is very urgent, which is to want, which you want to tell them? Which one you will tell first? The information which you need to tell them, which is very important, right? That is what here, when you set any data with an urgent flag, so which indicates at the receiver side, okay, prior to processing of that data, I think I need to process this data. I think what that the sender process is indicating to process prior to the other data what has been sent by them earlier. Okay, that is what urgent flag. So in order to give the pointers, meet the starting byte value and the ending byte value, here for this, when they are set with an urgent flag, which consists of some data, and to know their starting byte value and the ending byte value, we have something other field called urgent pointer. I think you recall that diagram what we discussed. There is a field called urgent pointer. I told you, right? Whenever we set this flag called urgent flag, to defines what is the starting byte value and the ending byte value of that urgent flag segment. So we use that urgent pointer field. Okay. So that is what the use of this urgent flag. And you know, you are aware about what is called acknowledgement flag, reset flag also understood. There is something called synchronization flag and the fin flag. And there is another flag called push flag. Okay. Push flag is something, it is something similar to an urgent flag. Okay. Whenever any of the data you would like to push, okay, to the receiver process, which you might, want to cancel the data which already been sent by the sender process. You thought that what I was sent, it would be wrong. I think I have to push some data prior that data being processed by the receiver. Okay. So in that case, we use something called push flag. Quite self, same thing, but we use in a different scenarios. What is called push and urgent flag. Okay, urgent flag is something to push a data which has to be processed by the sender or receiver. Push flag is something, piece of data they wants to process prior to the data, or it could be a receiver process they wants to process the data which they pushed, which is not to that processors. Okay, that is what we said them as push flag. It's almost give the same meaning of what is called urgent and the push, I think you should be knowing what when we use an argent flag, and you should when we use this push flag. Okay, so this is all the six control fields we have, and you can see the description of that. What is called push the data, and argent flag is something the value of the argent pointer field is valid. Okay, acknowledgement and sin and fin and so on and so forth. Now we will understand. So in which way the sender, or let us say we use a terminology like now client and a server, okay, how they want to build a connection. Okay, now we said so there were three phases has been happened is going to be happen in every TCP kind of delivery of data. First it will build a connection, virtual connection, then it will send a data, then it will terminate the connection. Okay, so the very first step, which is called connection establishment. In a connection establishment, the sender is always send its first packet is SYN packet or SYN segment, we say. So what it mainly consists of, that packet or that segment, it only consists a sequence number which is defined by the client. Okay, so that sequence number should be known to whom? To a server. The rest packet, the data what it will send by, it will be sent in the same range of sequence number, whatever the client has been synchronized. Okay, so that what we set them as SYN flag, SYN packet or SYN segment, because the set packet will be consisting of only a sequence number. Okay, before that, prior to, you can see this timeline. So there will be some two terminologies like active open and passive open. What do you mean by that? So passive open is something whenever any processes which is running on a server, it is always keep open that port number to accept the connection from the client. The client, it will not always keep open their port number to transfer a data to a server. Instead, it will be initiated by the user when they are using that application. Okay, so that is what active open means. At any time that could be active and it can send the SYN flag. But if you see at the server side, it is always be a passive open, because if that is a passive open, then only the connection at any point of time, if client they are requested for, okay, then only it will establish. Okay, so the first kind of transaction which will happen between for a connection establishment is sending a SYN flag, SYN segment from client to a server. Okay, by setting up the synchronization flag to one, and it will put in the sequence number field the sequence number that is utilized by the client to send their data. Here, in this example, they use 8000, and it will be sent from your client to server. As a received by a receiver, it sends an SYNACK packet. Means the server would also initialize its own sequence number is what it utilized used by. It will not be used the same sequence number. Okay, both of them will use a different sequence number for data transfer. So what we were assuming here is the data is always be a bidirectional, which is mean by piggybacky process, right? What we understood in data link layer, right? Piggybacky is something the data will be sent from two ports. Both the client will send a data and even server will also send a data to a client. So to transfer this data from the both the side, they have to synchronize with their own sequence number value, right? The client will be using 8000 and your server will be using 15000 sequence number, and server will be sending an acknowledgement because it received the SYN segment and it has to send an acknowledgement, right? So I got your sequence number what you will be using, and this is what my acknowledgement. You have to start sending a data from 8000 one byte. So what this indicate here for the connection establishment, what the client will be sending that SYN flag, it will be consuming one sequence number in that sequence, in that segment. It only consisting of a sequence number, it will not consist any of the data. Okay, it will not include any data, it's only it will include a sequence number. One sequence number will be consumed for synchronization. Okay, and the same time you can see what the response is sent by a server, which is SYNACK flag, SYNACK segment. It is also consuming one sequence number for synchronization. In that segment also, it will not consist any data. Okay, and it will consist an acknowledgement number
and you can see in the six control flag it set EA and as well as yes, because see, it will also synchronizing and it's also sending an acknowledgement, right? After that, your client will send an acknowledgement packet what the SYN segment is received by the server. Means it will send only an acknowledgement, and acknowledgement is 15001. So even it can use the same sequence number to send that acknowledgement back to the server. Okay. So when this is this process, we set them as three-way handshaking. The client will send a SYN flag, a server will send SYN ACK, and again client will send ACK. Okay, just keep this in mind. SYN, SYN ACK, ACK. So this process we set them as three-way handshaking for what? For building a logical connection between a client and a server. This is what the connection establishment process, which happens for every the data which is sent and received, means request and response from the client and server, between the client and server. Okay. Okay. So SYN, just what I said, SYN segment cannot carry any data, but it will be consuming one sequence number for synchronization. Similarly, SYN ACK segment cannot carry any data, but it will also consume one sequence number for synchronization with client. Acknowledgement segment will not carry any data, and even it will not consume any sequence number. Okay, later on is what the data transfer phase. Okay, after that it will use 8001, and it will put data of 1000 bytes, means 8001 to 9000 in the data field, and it will set what is called A and P. Okay, what here is the P is something push this data to a receiver process, okay, which is running at the receiver server. Okay, similarly, you can see in this example, two data segments has been sent by from a client, and one segment has been sent by a server. Okay, after that, again, client has sent one another segment to the server. This is what the data of sending of between your client and the server. So you can see two segments has sent. Okay, consisting of data 1000 in each packet, like from 8001 to 9000, 9001 to 10000. But here, what the server has sent, so it has to send an acknowledgement for what? The data value which is received by the sender, which is 10000 is the last. It will now requesting to send the 10001 byte. 10 means the next byte value of what that byte is received by the receiver. Okay, and the sequence number it used 15001. 15,000 is synchronized in the first phase, in the connection establishment phase. It will use 15,001 onwards. And what was the data size it will put in this data? It is something nearly 2,000 bytes value. Okay. For that, your client will send an acknowledgement like 17,001. 17,000 bytes are received, and you say, I'm expecting from 17,001 byte. Okay. And if you put the sequence number, is what? The last one, the byte value of the last, which is 10,000, has to be set as the sequence number. You go back and recall what the sequence number, it is always be the first byte value will be the sequence number used by every segment. Okay, it will send an acknowledgement. By that time, it will send a receiver window size defined as 10,000. Okay, so that is what this data transfer phase. And the last one is connection termination phase. Connection termination is the same process, but this process could be takes place in two ways, which is we called as three-way handshaking or halfway close. Okay, let me explain you that in next slide. So how this connection termination would take place by doing this three-way handshaking. So in the connection establishment, we discussed SYN, SYN ACK, ACK, but the process here is the same, but instead of setting a synchronization flag, we use something called FIN flag. FIN, FIN ACK, ACK. Okay, this process is used whenever both the entities, like client and a server, they wants to close their connection, both of them. Like client also wants to terminate the connection with the server, and even server would also terminate the connection with the client. So in that case, we use this mechanism, which is three-way handshaking. FIN. So your client will initiate to close the connection with the server by sending the FIN segment. Okay, so it will set a sequence number as X, and acknowledgement could be a Y for the packet which is received by a server. As they are received by a server, and
Again, server would also requesting to terminate a connection to a client by sending a fin as well as an acknowledgement for what the fin segment is received by the client. Okay, and for that, as it received by a FinAct packet by a client, your client has to send an ACK packet back to the server saying your request would also accepted and I'll terminate your connection. And this is what my acknowledgement to you. So which is ACK. Okay, it is similar to your the connection establishment phase. Okay, both the same here. Fin segment consumes one sequence number, but it doesn't carry any data. And FinAct also it will consumes one sequence number, it doesn't carry any data. But acknowledgement is not carries any data and it will even not carries any sequence number. Okay, there is another way we use something called off clause. Off clause in some scenario or in some applications might use this kind of communication between the client and the server. What do you mean by off clause? Something a client want to terminate the connection with the server, but server don't wants to terminate the connection with the client because server wants to keep push some data to the client. Okay, in that time what this off clause is going to be used. Another we would also call this as four-way handshaking. So four-way handshaking is what here is. You can see in this diagram, client is wanted to close the connection with the server, so it will send a fin segment. Okay, what the fin segment is received by a server, only that request you will send an acknowledgement, means the connection has been terminated, but server will be keep connecting with the client because he wants to send some data to the client. Okay, you can see after the connection is established, from a client to server there will be no data to send, but from a server to client there will be data to be sent by your server to a client. Okay, in that case your client connection will be terminated, but your server will have a connection with the client. So the data segment from server to client has been sent, but your client will only send an acknowledgement. It will not going to send any data to the server. Okay, it will only send an acknowledgement from a client to segment, whatever the segment data segment is received by the server. After the server has completed his data transfer to a client, probably he will going to initiate the connection termination by sending the fin flag, the fin segment, and your client will going to acknowledge that. So okay, I will going to connection. So this is what we said, the mass off close, or we said also call it as four-way handshaking. Okay, so and you all know for comes to the flow control and error control, so much of concept we already discussed in data links here. Something called sliding window protocols, and in that we discuss GBN, SR. Okay, sliding window protocols used to make transmission more efficient as well as to control the flow of data so that destination does not become overwhelmed with data. TCP sliding windows are byte oriented. Okay, so there is something some problems on that. A simple example, you can see what's the value of the receiver window for a host A if the receiver to host B has a buffer size of 5000 bytes and the 1000 bytes of received and unprocessed data. Okay, what do you mean by that? So the buffer size is 5000 and 1000 byte has received and they are unprocessed, means which they cannot be able to unprocess. The 5000 minus 1000, which should be defined as the value of the, or I would say the receiver will have a buffer size of 4000 bytes, means at one time it can be hold of 4000 bytes. As they get slided, it can be now it can capable of again put a new 4000 bytes of data. Okay, same thing here also. What is the size of the window for the host A? Is the value of the receiver window is 3000 bytes and the value of the sender window size is 3500, means 3500 is 5000 bytes is your sender window size and 3000 byte is the receiver window size. And what is the size of the sender window size? Even in this case, receiver window size is less but sender window size is high. It is always be the minimum of either of these two, 3000 or 3500, which is the sender window size also be set to what? 3000. Okay, that is what the answer. Okay, and this is how it will be slided, you know, the slice and some points about TCP sliding window, something acknowledgement segment should not consume a sequence number. Modern implementation, a transmission occurs if the retransmission timer expires or three duplicate acknowledgement segment. This mechanism, something you can go back and look at your, it leads to have n retransmission. Okay, something we used to have something called timers, and if that expires or if three duplicate packet is arrived, say segment is arrived, we used to only in that time retransmission timer is set for an acknowledgement segment. And data may arrive out of the order and can be temporarily stored in the receiver by receiving, but TCP guarantees that no out of order segment is delivered to the process. Means even though the outer order segment is comes, I will be keep them in the buffer, and I will be guaranteeing that only when the inner order packet comes, then only we give them for the processing by receiver process. Okay. This is what the common operations which can take place. Like you can see the sequence number 1000, 201, 2004. Okay, means is that size of bytes is been like added in this segment. It will be sent from client to server, and client will also use some other sequence number 4001 to 5000, which is the range of byte what we used in this, and it will also send. There will be timer something 500 millisecond. So after that, it will send an acknowledgement. Okay. Similarly, the next two segment again sent by a server. Then later it will be sent an acknowledgement. This is how the normal operation would take place. So how is this? If there is a loss of segment, okay, you just recall there will be some mechanism what we discussed. These are all something which will be an inbuilt procedure in your flow control protocols, right? If there any packet which is not received, okay, and the timer then should request them to retransmit that packet, since I would not receive that yet. Something you know that, right? Automatic repeat request. So stop and wait ARQ, GBN, and SR protocol. Each of these flow control protocols have an something a built-in features for if they have any packet as lost. Okay, so that is what this here is again explained in this diagram. So receiver TCP delivers only order data has been processed. Once they are received all these inner order packets, and if they are reassembled, and then the receiver process will be able to process the data by capturing that from which is stored in the receiver buffer. Okay. And there is something called fast retransmission. It's something what we just thought of. We made change to the previous one in a retransmission mechanism. Okay. So which intends to give something fast way of retransmission process. Okay. So this is all about something about to mainly look at in this module, or comes to the topic of TCP is its header format, and that six flags and its significance or its responsibility or its functionality, and this three way which is connection, how a connection establishment will take place, and what is the data transfer phase. You should clearly write that packet in detail and have to explain each one of them. And when it comes to the last one, the phase which is connection termination, how this could be takes place either in a three-way handshaking, or even I could ask handshaking, or we would also call them as half close. So this is the end of your TCP module. Any doubts so far? And SETP, I told you this is something out of scope. SETP is a message-oriented, reliable protocol that combines both the features, the advantages features that what we saw in TCP. Okay, something it's just a different applications we use for ISDN or a network, or something we use for SSL server and telephone signaling. We use this for IP phones like H.223 or SIP protocols, which is all these are something. Okay, for that kind of applications, so we use this protocol which is called SETP. It is something different concept. So come on. So if you have any doubts, you can ask me. Any doubts? It's the last concept, and this is what the last presentation for the entire course. So we were discussing about what is called congestion control and quality of service. Okay, so what is these two terms are? Okay, what do you mean by congestion? Okay, congestion could often takes in networks. What do you mean by congestion here is, so when any network load or a traffic which is go beyond the capacity of the network, so we call that as means whenever you're going in a road and something you don't have space to drive your vehicle, so what we say that as is something traffic. Okay, traffic overloaded, something you said, right? Something like that. Whenever there is a no space to move your data or what you might send on network and which is go beyond the capacity of the network, we set them as congestion. Okay, how are you gonna avoid this congestion? Okay, so there are two. So preventing this congestion is what is a one method. So we use some policies or some algorithms for preventing this congestion prior to the happening of that congestion. After the congestion is happened, how you can control it, how you can remove that congestion in a network is another strategy or is another mechanism. We have set of protocols or an algorithms to removal of congestion in a network after a congestion is happened, and we have a mechanism or an algorithm or a protocols to prevent the congestion prior to that congestion would takes place. Okay, so how you want to control them? So we use set of algorithms or a protocols to control this congestion over a network, and then what is called quality of service. Service is what, so we need to ensure a service, a better quality to every users or every customers. Okay, so what everybody use today, the internet services, something data, it's something is completely free, only we are paying for the quality of service, right? So you, everybody will have a package, right? 399, everyone recharged for your phone, something you will be get 1.5 GB every day as free, something you will get at very high speed, but later you would, could still use an internet, but the speed is what you'll get 64 kbps. It's very less. I'm not sure even you will get 64, it will go beyond, like even lesser than that. Probably you will be operating at something 10 kbps, and any application will not run if you use the speed of 10 kbps. Okay, so and we, any other anything than that, we lost the patient. So that's the one major point here.
okay, ensuring the quality of service and what are all the protocols we used for the guaranteed quality of service. We should have guaranteed quality of service. I should not have any fluctuation or any drop and something peak. I should not don't want that. I think what I enrolled for, I bid for, you should ensure that for me at least. Means if I taken a 30 Mbps speed, okay, I should get a 30 Mbps. I not expect that you should provide a 50 Mb. I just want my 30 Mb, that is sufficient. Please ensure from your end. So what, how you want to ensure that quality service? Something we should implement a protocol, right? So if they take requesting for 30, I should provide them a 30. If anyone else is requesting 50, I should provide them a 50 Mbps. If another one, if they are requesting 100, I should be able to something quality of service will be different. We have different profiles. Okay, I should have a mechanism or a protocol ensuring their what's the customer and what is the required by them and the quality. Okay, the service, what the speed they need, I have to be ensured it. I should be guaranteed. Okay, and what are the protocols we used or the mechanisms or service techniques. Okay, so that is where we are focusing on this present. Okay, so before getting to this, let me find this. We will send a data. Okay, every application is send a data, and let us say we know that every system now can run with multiple data. Okay, each application, like every system will be able to running multiple applications, and each application could send its own data, right? As there comes an application, and whatever the data has been sent by each application individually, that we, if I take an instant, a picture on a link of an which is connected in the network, how many packets they were sending, and how many applications, like application packets, like HTTP, how many packets were there, FTP, how many packets were there, something like that. Each, the different applications data, we send them as a traffic, or simply you can visualize. Or else, any host, if they are sending their data, irrespective of the application data, you simply call them as a traffic. Okay. So the traffic descriptor here, the qualitative values that represents at a data flow. Okay. So the data flow, the qualitative value that the data flow, we set them as a traffic or traffic descriptor. Okay, there are some terminology you might already know about what is called data rate. Data rate is something, it refers to the bandwidth, and average data rate, peak data rate, maximum burst size, and something called effective bandwidth. Effective bandwidth is something throughput or effective bandwidth utilization, something, you know that, right? You already discussed. The bandwidth that the network needs to allocate for traffic flow, that is what effective bandwidth. And what is average data rate is the amount of data per time, okay, over a period of time. And what is peak data over a period of time, what is my the maximum data rate. Okay, when you are downloading something, at some point you could be able to download them at 1 MB, later it could be downloaded at 100 kbps. Okay, so what is the average data, or means how many time you taken to download that file, and what is the average the data rate you get to download that file is what average data rate. Peak data rate, what is the maximum the speed that you got when you downloaded, which is called peak data rate. And duration of that peak data rate means you might be getting 1 Mbps for 10 seconds, which is what we set them as here is maximum burst size. Okay, so that is what in this diagram you can see, the average data rate, the peak data rate, and the maximum burst size means how long you get the maximum data rate, which is defined as maximum burst size, and there is another called effective bandwidth. Okay, so this is what something comes into your traffic descriptors. Okay, then there is something called when we set them as a traffic. Okay, like each host can now generate a traffic, right? So the data in terms we set them as a traffic now. So that could be, you can profile them in three categories. One is CBR, VBR, and BusD profile. There are three profiles. A host will be generating the data at a constant rate. We set them as CBR, constant bit rate. Okay. Means I set an application and I fix them that application only produce the data at a speed of 1 Mbps. We set that application as CBR, belongs to a traffic profile of CBR. Means that application belongs to that profile. Means it will generate a traffic at a constant rate. Okay, what is VBR then? Something it is fluctuate, variable bit rate. Okay, so it's something it will not be fixed. Something it can go lower, it can go higher bit rate. Something it might be an average, something it could be anything. I cannot write a specific graph for that, how it could take place. Okay, the second one defines that your variable bitrate graph, can understand. And another one, another profile is called BusD profile, traffic profile. What it means that, so at one instant, at one point time, so there will be a very peak data rate, and then it will be comes to an idle, there will be no data at all, and again it could be some average data rate. Okay, there will be no consistency in the data. Something high, then completely idle, again would be some data. Okay, so if you look at these profiles, I could say the data at the CBR are the regulated kinds of traffic. Means it's a regulated, means there is a consistent and a common speed rate of data from the application, where in variable and busty they are unregulated traffic flow. Means I cannot expect that when that the traffic flow will be high and when the traffic flow will be very low. But here in CBR, it is completely normal and it will be going one straight line, something like that.
This suggestion is right from here. Congestion, the load on a network is greater than the capacity of the network. Obviously, that's right. And that situation, we set them as congestion. Okay. How are you going to control it? Congestion control is a mechanism to control the congestion and keeps the load below the capacity of the network. Okay, so if you control the below the capacity of the network, of the network load, then you will, the term we set them as congestion control. Okay, and congestion occurs when, where this congestion would takes place. This would takes place on a router switches, because each of these devices have something called queues and buffer, and that actually is holding off these packets before and after the processing of that package. If they have sufficient resources and based on their incoming and outgoing flows of traffic, if they have sufficient resource and they are doing smoothly without any lagging, something there will be no congestion. If any, at any situation, if they are lagged with any of this data or processing or sending to a proper destination, then that leads to have a situation of what is called congestion. Okay, you can see the rate of a packet arrival is what the packet processing time, and the input queue longer. Okay, means the time at which that packet is held on by a queue, and the packet departure time is something packet processing time plus outgoing queue. The packet is held by an outgoing queue in that device. Okay, which is called departure time. So what if happens if congestion in a network, that leads to directly impact on your network performance, right? If you if there is a congestion in a network, then you will not able to process like anything, whatever you request. Something might be heard in some scenario when you call to someone, you'll get a response from your like when you are calling from cellular system saying that your call cannot be connected due to congestion in a network. Are you heard about anyone? You heard about this kind of an information as what you get from whenever you call someone to through your phone, isn't it? Means when you call someone, it will say this call cannot be connected due to congestion in the network. Means the resources what that cell, that base station will be having, it is completely utilized by the users. Means you don't have any resource to get connected. Means could be a frequency, or it could be it's only the frequency itself. if one, if anyone get disconnected, and that frequency could be used by you to connect, like to call your friend, something like that. So if there is a congestion, means your packet will not be able to send to a destination. Instead, wherever this congestion has happened, at that point itself, your packet get dropped. Okay, that's simple. Okay, due to this congestion, what, how this going to be affect on the delay? Okay, so what is called the packet delay? Packet delay versus network load. Okay, you can see in the x-axis we return them a capacity of a network, and the y-axis we write them as a packet delay. As a packet delay gives increases, okay, at certain capacity, okay, so will be no congestion. You can see the green, yellow, green in, like yellow in color, okay. As we increasing with the load, okay, there will be increasing with the capacity, sorry, the delay. Further, if you go beyond that capacity, something it will be, it's to have the congestion. Okay, this is what the traffic means. Delay ID composed with the propagation delay and as well as the, this delay what I'm representing is proportionated with both the propagation delay as well as the processing delay. Okay, or transmission time or TP, TT or DP, something like that. Another network performance it may be affected on with the help of throughputs, throughput versus network load. So at the non-congestion area, you can see you will be getting a better throughput, but in a congestion area, obviously it is exponentially get decreased with that throughput due to congestion. Means how much the packet you send, you will every packet will be get dropped due to congestion. Congestion control mechanism. So as I told you, there are two categories, which open loop and a closed loop, where open loop refers to the prevention mechanism and closed loop is refers to the removal of congestion whenever a congestion takes place. Okay, so there are different policies we use, something retransmission policies, window policies, acknowledgement policies, discarding policies, and admissions policies. These are the protocols or a mechanism or a policies we used for preventing the congestion prior to the congestion. But removal of congestion after the congestion takes place is what? Back pressure, choke point, choke packet or choke point, we say. And another one is implicit signaling and explicit signaling. So look at each one of them. What is called retransmission policies? So we had something in retransmission policies, and timers must be designed to optimize the efficiency at any same point, at any same time, preventing the congestion. Okay, I think we should have a retransmission policies, like by having that timer been and have to design that to an very optimized to get an better network performance. Okay, so is what instead of using a GBN, if you would have something called SR, it has a retransmission policies, like if one packet is lost, only that packet has to be retransmitted. Okay, but in GBN it's something, if one lost n packet is retransmitted, something that could itself be a kind of building and congestion in a network. Okay, that is what one thing. And window policies, we know that again SR would be better than a GBN, because what GBN would have only receiver window is one. Due to that, it will not accept the outer order packets, isn't it? One by one it has to accept. And what the efficiency, like it could in a SR, we have something called both the same window size at the sender and the receiver. So with that, where you could prevent this congestion. Okay, so we suggested to use at the topper layer, which is called SR, than using the GBN. Okay, and the acknowledgement policy is something you might be knowing. Instead of using individual acknowledgement mechanism, we use something called cumulative based acknowledgement mechanism. Instead of sending every one acknowledgement for every packet, you're going to send only one packet for a bunch of one acknowledgement for a bunch of packet. Okay, that is what acknowledgement policies. And we itself told you that, like in an individual acknowledgement, what is the disadvantage here is high traffic, because of every packet, if you send 1,000 packets, 1,000 acknowledgement packet has to be sent by a receiver. Okay, that makes a congestion possibly. And discarding policies, okay, preventing a congestion at the same time may not harm the integrity of the transmission. Okay,
So we should have a proper discarding policies, so which helps to even for preventing of congestion in a network. And there is something called admissions policies or admission control. We say switch first check the resource requirement before you admit the flow of traffic in the network. Okay, is what before I have to check how many seats are available in an event, and you want to check how many of them are already filled and how many are vacant and how many are they are coming to get inside that room. Okay, is what somebody will stand in the front of door where a people will get and fill to that room. Something like that is what here. You should priorly known whether the available bandwidth for this traffic flow is present in a network. If so, then you can admit. Otherwise, you should set them deny there itself. Is what admission policy mechanism, which could also provides me the congestion prevention. Okay. And another one is closed loop. After the congestion takes place, how are you going to overcome them? Like, how you make them congestion free? So there were four policies that we use. One is back pressure, choke point, and implicit signaling and explicit signaling. So back pressure is something at some point you can see in the first diagram. There is, that is what the flow of traffic, data flow from your source host to destination. In between, one of the device, what called router, might be a very lower end device. It doesn't have much memory or computation or something you can think of. When you send a data to it, and that router may not be able to process at the rate what the sender will be sending, or the intermediate device might also sending. In that case, what that device will do, it will send a back signaling, which we call them as back pressure. Okay, means to whom? The complete downstream networks, downstream devices, means the next router, first, second one, third, first one, and the source. I will be sending a signaling to all of them, a downstream devices, saying that to slow down their phase of transferring of data. So with this helps so that I can make that congestion which has happens at that point could be removal. If they are slowed down, probably next the data what I will send will not be congested. Something that is what back pressure. Inform the previous upstream routers to reduce the rate of outgoing packet if they congested, which is called back pressure. Okay. So if someone will push to you, you just tell them, don't push me. If I push, I will go front and I'll fall. Something like that, you can tell them like that. That is what here is what congestion, how you can avoid them removal by sending an information that here might be a congestion, slow down their sending of the data. Otherwise, the congestion will be still persist or it will be ghost like that itself. Then there is a choke point. Choke point is what, instead of telling them to all of them, the backstream routers, that device will directly intimate or it will send the information to a source. So the source itself being phased, slow down their phase of transmission of data is another one. So because they were the neighbors or the intermediate device, they will send the rate at which what the source will be sending. If at the source itself, if I can cut down the speed at which what they are transmitting, I think probably even that could also avoid of congestion, right? So that is what we call choke point. Choke point is a packet sent by a router to a source to inform it of congestion, similar to how we do something called ICMP quench messages. Okay. ICMP quench, you recall that ICMP what we discussed, it will be something error querying messages and error reporting messages. In that error reporting messages, there is something called ICMP source quench. Okay. That what here similar to your congestion control, which is called choke point. And another one is implicit signaling and explicit signaling. If something slow down its sending rate by detecting an implicit signal concerning to an congestion. Okay. If something, the source itself should have implicit signaling by detecting, and they would slow down their sending rate, which concerns to the congestion avoidance. Okay. Explicit signaling, it is something, a kind of
sent either backward and as well as the forward way. So what do you mean by that? Backward, informing the source to slow down their phase of transmitting the data, or else in forward, I'm going to inform this to a destination so that it can make that environment to receive at a fast rate and process that data very fast. Something could also be kind of explicitly informing that destination to could be there is a chance that due to congestion, probably at one instance you may receive a burst kind of data. Right? So that is what is called congestion removal in a network if that happened. Okay, these were the four strategies or policies that we were going to use. Okay, how this congestion control would be avoided in TCP? Okay, so this TCP is how means. So what the TCP, the sender and the receiver will decided on what the size of a packet I should send. That will use a policy called slow start exponentially increasing policy. What do you mean by that here is, the sender will start sending the data with the small amount. Let us say sender will send with 100 bytes first. As you get an acknowledgement for complete 100 bytes, next time as the sender will send, it will increase that window size. Means next I will send 200 bytes and I will send to a receiver. If the receiver will send an acknowledgement for a whole 200 bytes, next I will increase 400 bytes. Next I will increase 6000 bytes. Like that, I'll keep exponentially increasing my data and I'll just look at whether a receiver will send an acknowledgement for a whole byte. So at some point, I think receiver window size also would be limited, right? When the response will send by a receiver for only specific, means the size of their bytes, what the window size that receiver has, it will only send the acknowledgement for the specific bytes. So when that acknowledgement is received by a sender, received by a sender, it will come to know that what is the receiver window size. Isn't it? I'll start with the minimum window size and I'll keep increasing that exponentially. Okay. And I'll keep looking at what is the acknowledgement which I get by a receiver at certain point where the your receiver window could be overflowed and what was the acknowledgement which I received for certain byte value. So the sender will fix that or that. Is the first size of and receiver. So I have to fix for that. Later it will gonna send only that much of data. Okay, that is mechanism what them as TCP congestion policy, which we set them as slow start exponentially increase. Okay, you can see here the congestion avoidance could be happens with the additive increase of the window size and checking of the acknowledgement for how many bytes. Okay, so this is what the congestion mechanism avoidance, because if any of the packet, if they are lost in a network due to of this congestion, how that cause could be removal, right? So by the TCP, so it will be adopted something what this slow rate exponentially increased. Okay, whenever a packet is lost, it could retransmit, but how you can remove that lost packet lost due to of congestion by using this policy called congestion avoidance policy is called slow rate exponential TCP policy, congestion policy. Okay, this is how we will do congestion control on WAN kind of a network, which is called frame relay kind of network. Okay, so I think this was not required. So we'll go to the next one, which is called quality of service. Do you have time? Do you have any next class? Do you have next class now?
Yes, sir.
On what time? Now only?
Yes, sir.
Okay, then we'll stop here. Probably I have to complete this one, quality of service. I think if I complete this, it's complete your complete whole course, which is computer network.